Thanks to all the speakers in the previous session. Now it's the question and answer time, and I see that some people have joined us to listen in on the Q&A. I trust that some of you, if you just joined, you've been watching the COSPAR webcast on the virtual platform. So we have the floor open to questions. If anybody, we're pretty relaxed here, actually, it turns out. So if anybody has a question they would like to ask, raise your hand and I can allow you to chat. Actually, Lorraine, can you make me host again? It seems like I cannot change the permissions of the people. Thank you. So if nobody has questions right now, let me first ask. Oh, there is a hand from Nikhil.
Hi, I have a question that's directed to Lorraine. One of the things that interests me about the Venus environment is the extreme heat environment. So I was wondering if you had ideas about how we could use autonomy to handle that specifically, like maybe deploying surface probes at opportune times to maximize the amount of information that they can return.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I can't say that we touched on it at the workshop, but we did talk about, you know, possibly if you do have these aerobots that are up in the upper atmosphere where the climate is not so harsh, possibly dipping down in to get a closer look at something, and we could use autonomy to ensure the health of the vehicle. So when things start reaching critical limits, perhaps we raise back up until we cool down again. So that might be one approach where autonomy would enable you to operate at harsher, hotter temperatures for shorter periods of time and just monitor that on board.
Okay, thank you. I have a question for Lorraine too. Maybe one aspect that you haven't mentioned, and maybe this is a far out idea, is self-repair. Is there any way that autonomy can help with the probes being aware that certain parts have maybe more damage than some other parts, and prioritize like how to swap out the spare parts once they have just gone back to a high altitude with the mothership?
Yeah, that's a neat idea. We have been doing work recently in detecting hardware degradation, and not just failures, but trying to, so if we do have harsh failures, you know, as long as there's some redundancy, whether it's physical redundancy or functional redundancy, there, you know, the combination of model-based approaches to health assessment plus onboard planners and schedulers can provide these capabilities to work around and adapt to your system. So some health assessment capabilities are using models now, so you can look at your sensor data's on board and your commands that are being sent to the hardware. And by having a model of how the system is supposed to work, you can compare the expected measurements to the onboard measurements and be able to not only detect when something goes wrong, but hone in on and identify a particular component that is causing the failure. And then you can swap that out, or perhaps with smart onboard planners, you can work around the problem or figure out parts of your plan that can still carry on even without that component working. So yeah, there's a lot of research in these areas: onboard planning, scheduling, smart execution, system health management, that we're finding. We just did an experiment recently with the Asteria CubeSat where we combined all these capabilities to kind of have a paradigm shift in how a spacecraft can operate without ground in the loop. And we used it to do autonomous navigation, but injecting failures and then working around them, there's definitely a lot of great work happening, at least in the research arena right now, if not starting to get into test beds and hopefully soon on board spacecraft.
Thank you. Are there questions from the attendees or other session speakers? If not, I would like to ask Nikhil. So Lorraine mentioned the onboard planning, and that was the topic of your talk. In your simulations, do you take into account the whole chain of image sensing and interpreting what is where to decide? It seems to me that is the very computational, the expensive part, and maybe much more than the optimization problem that you might describe.
Yeah, it's true. I think part of the reason why I wanted to focus more specifically on the task optimization has a lot to do with the nature of a sequential bye-bye operation. So the idea being, if you send spacecraft ahead of each other, then they can react to the information from the spacecraft in the front of the in the front of the train, I guess. So my thought is that if you the idea is to attempt to globally optimize over the entire swarm. So if the train or if the leading spacecraft detects in an image a region of interest, being able to optimize over the entire swarm as fast as possible will help to enable spacecraft in that are further in the back of the train to actually maneuver to try to increase the amount of science available. The faster that process happens, the more availability that there is for a maneuver to take place. Obviously, there has to be additional optimization as far as the image processing itself, but there's already been a fair amount of work done in the literature to handle that exact problem.
Okay, yeah, I can definitely see how that's its own big problem to tackle already. So in your ConOps scenario, is there inter-spacecraft communication?
Yeah, so there would kind of have to be. There would probably not be an inter-satellite link in between each spacecraft, but I think more along the lines of a spacecraft would communicate their information to the next spacecraft in the sequence. So the global optimization would get performed every time that happens. So every time a new piece of information gets added, as a result of the actual windows being so short, the optimization inside of the windows can't happen really. So as soon as any particular spacecraft undergoes an operation, then that information gets passed back along the train.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, I should check Slido just in case there are some questions. Okay, so there are no questions on Slido. I am going to really open the floor up and we're very relaxed here. If no one has other questions, I can ask for a long time. I actually just realized that Eric is online now. So Eric, thanks for joining and we heard your talk. So I have a question about your talk for the, in terms of how you were saying that the data from the engineering unit, not from the actual, the data during the mission is not really that suitable for doing machine training in order to extract the science. Is there enough similarities between instruments between different missions that you can use the heritage data as a guidance, or using also physical simulations and having the whole chain of instrument degradation, but accounting for the different scenarios of the systematics of the noise levels in order to enable you to be able to use machine learning to train the model that you can then deploy on the satellite, on the mission?
Yeah, there's two parts to that question. I guess I could turn my video on, but I'm not sure how to do it. But there's part of the problem, our ETU is really very much like our flight instrument. So the data from it is perfectly good for training our machine learning. The trouble is the way the ETU has been used, it wasn't like systematically shown different samples. So the data has a lot more of one thing and less of another and none of something else that could be of interest in flight. Mm-hmm. So we, in an ideal world, we would have had a test plan early on, mm-hmm. and run a set of samples pre-chosen for the machine learning. So that's one of our big findings, is like we have good data and we can learn from it, but it's not as good as it could be. The second problem is the MoMA data is very specific to MoMA, and this is kind of an important finding for, I think, any instrument that's going to try to use machine learning in a space application. It's MoMA was built very specifically to look for certain things on Mars. It's an ion trap mass spectrometer. So we can't, data from say a different kind of mass spectrometer won't work. It's just not similar enough. Different mass spectrometers, for instance, they fragment molecules in different ways depending on the frequency and the power of the laser and so on. So there's no commercial equivalent to our instrument, and there's never been another ion trap ever flown in space, so we don't have any data from space. So we've looked around and we can't find any suitable data set except from our engineering unit. And I don't want to say it's a bad data set, but it's not great for machine learning. It's not optimized. If we had thought of this 5 years ago, we would have said, oh, you know, let's create this set of samples and test like this and test this and test this, and that would really help our training. So instead, we're kind of stuck with what was used for testing the instrument, finding limits of detection, and determining the sort of characteristics of the instrument, so rather than for machine learning. So the point I kind of want to make in the talk is that future instruments, you really want to be looking at this early, because I think MoMA is not unusual in that it's unique. Like, its data is not like a data from commercial instruments. When you send an instrument to another planet, it tends to be really highly tuned for what it's looking for. And you don't look up for life on Earth. You would never make such an instrument on Earth, for instance, because it's very good at finding something that's very common on Earth. It's unnecessarily tuned for finding that. So anyway, that's the point I was trying to make. And another thing you might do for future instruments is make them more similar to a commercial instrument, so you could get data from Earth-based instruments. Does that answer your question, Mark?
Yes. But of course, scientists are quite demanding and want the best. And want the best detectors and instruments. So often that doesn't come with using off-the-shelf parts.
Right.
So,
they're highly optimized for what they're looking for, which is they should be, but it's something to be aware of if you're applying machine learning.
Yeah. Thank you. I would like to ask Luis a question. So, full disclosure, I'm a co-author of this work. In fact, I was one of the mentors of this team at Frontier Development Lab. So the way you describe how we try to track the degradation of the AIA instrument, I guess you describe that it looks at the spatial features and find the relationships to give the degradation factor. So it doesn't really go back to a sort of physics theory of why it should be that you can use that multi-channel data to give the factor. So do you have difficulty convincing other scientists in the solar physics domain that this is a trustworthy method?
Can you rephrase that? It's kind of confused for me. Can you?
Do you have have you had difficulty with scientists who are not familiar with machine learning or even familiar with machine learning in trusting that the method that is described is reliable?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, we are still not sure exactly how it works, or the whole retrieving the degradation factor. So this kind of lack of explaining put everyone's like in skeptical mode about this. But most of the researchers that I have been talking to, and I have presented the work, when we compare with the results that they have been using before, using like the degradation curves from like from older methods, in the paper I mentioned V8 and V9, and now we have V10 already. So since our results are so close, they trust the results, but they are still skeptical on what is happening. And this is a very challenging thing to explain, even because we all, like me and you, we are also not sure how the machine learning is retrieving these degradation factors. We have some clues. We did a lot of testing. But still it's like a still kind of black box. So this part is put every scientist in skeptical mode. And then, but when we compare with the results, we like our ground truth, they become more open to what the machine learning can bring to this kind of problem.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that. And I probably want to bring that back to maybe Lorraine and Eric, or anyone who's, on here, whether when you're talking about machine learning or autonomous capabilities, that your colleagues are super skeptical and they don't want to even give you their ear, and how do you approach at least getting the conversation going so that we can actually try to develop and have investments in this direction?
Well, we've had pretty good luck with the science team. They've been really enthusiastic because we're trying to help them. We're trying to write software tools to help them. So we've had really good collaboration with the science team. We worked closely with them, and we held workshops with them to show them what we're doing. And I think we were fortunate because our science team was pretty receptive to what we were doing. Still, we're only adding value. If we were actually filtering results, for instance, and choosing what we sent back to Earth from Mars, I think there'd be much more skepticism and difficulty. And on the next mission, I want to start our machine learning efforts earlier and really establish trust. Like we talked about, a trust readiness level, a TRL level for our AI, and bring the scientists in very early in in an instrument development.
I'll second what Eric said. I think, I'm skeptical of machine learning and some AI myself, so I don't just embrace it because it's cool stuff. I think tackling this with on the science end first and showing how it can augment and provide additional capabilities that you didn't have before is a great approach. For now, I think it's smart to keep it out of the main control of the spacecraft. I don't think anyone is yet comfortable with handing over control of the spacecraft to an artificial intelligence or especially a machine learning based approach. And we can see that in a lot of the autonomous driving for cars that's happening right now. There's still much work to be done before we can prove that that's going to be viable. I mean, we're getting a lot closer, but cars also have the luxury of maybe pulling over off to the side of the road where spacecraft, some can go into a safe mode, but we just need to be really careful in trying to tackle the main control of the hardware. So I agree with Eric, keeping it as an augmentation. Gee, look at all the great stuff we could do if we add this capability that you couldn't do before. Is a great approach.
Can I add something to what they said? I agree. I mean, what just presenting machine learning as an add-on to whatever you are doing as an augmentation. But also I try also when I'm presenting my work, I also try to use machine learning as a to open more scientific questions. So for example, in this work I presented, if a machine can somehow retrieve the degradation factors, there are some relationships that we are not exactly aware about yet. I mean, we have some guesses, but we don't know the mathematical behind it or how to relate the frequencies of the AI channels exactly. And the machine learning it can open these questions and show, oh, there is a lead here. We can investigate that and it shows a direction we can go and say, okay, if the machine can do, we can try to find out how it's doing. And I think that's an important factor also.
Right. And certainly there are areas where physics-informed machine learning, or maybe even other domains like chemistry-informed machine learning, play a role where the governing equations or the theory, the established theory behind certain phenomena is built into to the machine learning pipeline, and then you can help to iterate and adjust parameters. So I think that there's a lot to explore there. And then yesterday we had in the Shirley Ho's talk in the machine learning for space science, there was basically machine learning based physics. So I think I encourage the attendees who are in this workshop on autonomy to also take a look at some of the talks on the machine learning for space sciences, that workshop that happened yesterday. There's really a lot of great content. And I would also like to mention that from these two workshops, the majority of the presentations are actually from students. So that's going against the cost bar demographic, but I think that's natural because this is a relatively new thing. I would like to close by, first of all, sharing a slide.
Mark, I think we still have a question from Jack Ireland.
Oh, Jack.
On the chat.
On the chat, let's see. Oh, there are two. Okay, there's one question, okay. Louis, it seems like the gains using multi-AIA channel varies depending on which channel is being reconstructed. Is this due to overlaps in the temperature filter response?
So that's a very good question. And this comes back like we
don't know exactly what the machine is doing. So I don't know. We did some analysis on that to understand why different channels were responding differently in the single channel models. And if you look, I didn't put in the presentation because it's just too much data, but for example, the 304 channel was doing good, really good in the baseline, which is extremely simple. And it did good in the single channel model, in the multi-channel model. We don't know how to explain that. We can try because the baseline is simple, but for example, in the 171 channel, the single channel model did better than the multi-channel model. It's hard to explain why. I mean, in both models, the machine had the same information of the channel. So it's kind of tricky to answer that. It comes back, we don't know what the machine is doing. And we did some investigation, there's some discussion in the paper, if you look at that, Jack. But I mean, I don't have a very clear answer. Maybe Mark have a better answer than me, but it's tricky to answer that.
It's not necessarily a better answer. Some channels experience more degradation on board than others. So there are differences there. And then the more you dig into this calibration problem, the more you realize that the traditional way people calibrate, even using sounding rockets, the magnitude of the uncertainties is not that clear. Because it's hard, because you have to take your instruments to NIST, to some EUV source and calibrate, and you have to make sure that this sounding rocket was the same as the previous one or not. So it's not easy. So I would like to share my screen for one final time here for all the attendees of the workshops. I would like to invite you, and you can invite your colleagues or friends to this social event, which is hosted by the SETI Institute, featuring Seth Shostak, who's a senior astronomer there. And the tagline or the title of this event is ML at SETI. And so there'll be discussions about how machine learning is being used in SETI and of course in space. So definitely looking forward to join you in a more informal event. And so take a picture of this. And I would like also to thank all the speakers of this workshop, as well as the technical organizing committee who did a lot of work in order to make this possible. So that includes Animesh Garg, Terry Fong, Eric Dixon, Sashi Jain, Alison Notes, Florence Tan, and James Parr for providing the advice and for helping to make this possible. I think we are at the end. The Q&A recorded sessions will eventually be posted up on the website also. And if you've missed any talks, I encourage you to learn. Just come back and look at the YouTube videos. I think even though it's sort of sad that we are not in person in Sydney, the benefit of having these pre-recorded talks is that it can be a resource that we can use over and over again. Let's see, there's one message from the chat. Okay, great. All right, if there's nothing else, then I would say good night, good morning, good evening to you all. And I hope to see you at the Cloud Computing for Space Sciences workshop tomorrow. Okay.
Thank you, Mark. You have amazing stamina.
I am tired. Thanks, everyone. Take care. Thank you. This was great. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.